when somebody is moving their arms or hands or animal, it's good to kind of picture what the skeletal structure is doing and then add the layers over that. It's like building a cake. If it's not cooked well underneath, all of that extra frosting won't really hide the fact that it's not really baked very well. So that's why it's good to really understand things from the inside out. This lesson is part of the Drawing Dynamic Creatures course. We have a full curriculum of content coming out that will make your drawings more dynamic and, of course, alive. So if you want to join us, head over to proko.com/drawingcreatures. We'll see you there. Let's start out with the giant chimpanzee skeleton. Now, I'm not going to draw all the ribs or anything like that, but you know, you will have access to these materials too, so go ahead and access them at your leisure. Just go with a basic profile for now. Let's keep it very simple. First thing to think about is don't get caught up in all of the nuances of the skeleton. This is a little bit smoothed out, this reference material here. If you're drawing from a real skeletal diorama like at a museum, you're gonna see a lot of different nuances in the bones and ridges, and you could get intimidated by it, you know? So this is kind of good. This is a little smoothed out here, you know, because it's a little bit more of a simplified objective structure. So even when dealing with the bones, I'm really dealing with rhythms. Not really worrying about so much about proportion even right now. It's generally a pretty spot on representation of shape relationships, but I'm not so worried about it right now. I mean, you can see how my follow through, how much bigger some of the foot appendages are, right? Really look for the flow. I talk about flow a lot because it creates more of an overall picture when you can actually find the flow of the actual subject. As you're trying to capture the energy and movement of your creature in a still image, you have to be thinking about the before and after, right? So I talk about flow of the action. In this instance, also talking about flow of skeletal structure and even the angles, right? You're probably like, David, you gotta slow down and I don't really know all the ridges you're doing. We're gonna get into it because we're actually gonna start studying the skulls. I'm just kind of laying it in quickly and loosely at this point. This is a basic setup for our chimpanzee. And the head is a little big. Let's even go in and pull that back a little bit. But I'm not so worried about proportion right now. We're focused on kind of the understanding of the different parts of that animal. Okay, let's start building upon this one. Once again, macro to micro. So I'm going to go with the rib cage, right? It's good to use cylinders. They're very soft and easy to manipulate. But then you want to start giving angles. So starting with the very objective shapes is good. And you want to take a more of a dimensional approach. Not a circle, but a more of a sphere. But as you proceed, you kind of start making up your own shapes as you're going along, right? So here's our ribs right here. And I'm just going to kind of lay in the general direction. Now you can see this little line here, right in there, doing the underside of the rib cage, the one that's facing the ground, the one that's parallel to the ground. So by putting that little line there, it's an indication that there's a plane change. And as we look at our 3D model, it's really nice having this material here, source material, you can do that. See how that change right there? That's what that little line is indicating, right? I'm not drawing every little rib. You can, but we want to understand the overall volumes, not so much the intricacies. Even as we kind of get into the vertebrae, I just kind of give it almost like a mohawk approach. These are things to kind of hone in on as you start doing your own creatures. I mean, you can actually, knowing that the vertebrae is there like that, maybe you kind of, if it's a creature that's emaciated and you want to make it feel, tell some story with it that it's had a long journey and it shows how ravished it is and it has like a raging, you know, primal hunger, you would start to kind of show a little bit more of the skeletal structure underneath. It gives a little bit more story. It shows the stakes of this creature and maybe why they're so aggressive. And here's one of those plane changes situations where it kind of comes out here. You can even see it, I believe, a little bit on the side, right? So you can see where that comes out on the bottom of the neck right there. That's something you can accentuate, you know, when you're dealing with your own creatures. That's what's so great. The more reference you have stuffed in that brain of yours, the greater your visual vocabulary will be and the more you can draw upon, pun intended, when creating your creatures. It's going to resonate more with your audience when you think about the narrative implications of your design choices. In the center of that spine, I just do a tube, just something like this. I'm not trying to see like how perfectly you can draw the skeleton. It's more about the understanding, what you take away from it. So they start to kind of think about the legs, right? I'm thinking about the pelvis as well. I'm just kind of generally laying it in. And our scapula, I'm going to start turning this soon. Let's really navigate around it. Now you can see Since I've kind of got a general basis from this area, I can always go back to it. Look at that scapula there as you look down upon it, right? So you have an idea in drawing from this angle where the ridges are. Really carve it out. Spine of the scapula there, right? It's the head of the humerus. And as it lays over the top of the ribcage, it is navigating the surface of the ribcage and bending over it, right? So it's not just this flat plane, you know, it's kind of actually conforming to the actual contour of the ribcage. So I can see now, I go back into this area, and still sticking with the flow of the initial gesture. And there's a gesture to the bones. Now, what's interesting is we start to get into, you know, apes per se. These are where we can start to see some proportions as well. The much longer forearms. I mean, look at the difference there between the upper arm, you know, the humerus, and then the radius and ulna. So much more massive and also much longer. I start to see a little bit of a ridge in there. This is what's so cool. You can start to turn it. You can see it a little clearer. Almost like it's bowing out a little bit, right? And the back of the elbow, the olecranon process there, which is the elbow there, that's what our ulna is. It usually runs down the side, and then the radius kind of curves over from the outside to in, right? And as you go ahead and turn this, you can see that. Just being very simple with it, very objective. Since I moved it, certain angles are going to change on things. But that's okay. It allows you to get a good understanding. There's a lot of great drawing books out there, but there's one, George Bridgman, The Human Machine, where he basically takes an arm and draws it from every different angle. That's how you really get to understand something, when you start being able to draw it from different angles. So because you have access to these materials, I mean, you want to really go for it. Start drawing it from every angle. Well, usually what I'll do is I'll just gesture in the other arm on the other side, but you can see how it's starting to overlap one another. It's hard to see where the hand is. So let's just go ahead and bump it out like that. Look how short their thumb is compared to the right metacarpals. Get an overall gesture in there first, thinking about the parts. I'm not going to get all to the intricacies of the carpals and all the different bones in there, but just more of a grouping. So you can get a general understanding of the proportion and how the hands actually lay and that bowing out of the bone right there, right? So when you're actually dealing with your creature that's walking on his hands, or her hands, see how it bows out and the knuckles will crunch. So you can see how this type of knowledge underneath would really determine and help this type of design knowledge and design choices, right? And the reason for those choices, not arbitrary, based on solid source material and having a good understanding of where those angles change. And use the comparison. If you notice some comparison where the knee is, right, to the elbow. The more you can arm yourself with this type of knowledge, the more successful your actual occupational assignments will be. Adding straights and curves is always good. Curves add a lot of flow and movement, but they can feel soft and not have much weight. Straights have a lot of weight and make your subject feel very solid, but they can feel clunky and not a lot of movement. So a perfect drawing, I should say, is a nice blend of both, right? So you kind of have to find that blend. What's kind of interesting when you get into this over here, you can work on what's the nice silhouette. Having a really nice, pleasing silhouette, even when dealing with designs that are a little bit more advanced and realistic, is still you want to kind of push for a pleasing silhouette. You could have intricacies, you know, of the different fur patterns and shapes and volumes as it kind of navigate through the silhouette of the form. But overall, it should still have a very pleasing silhouette. If you look at even when they design like costumes for, you know, characters in Marvel movies and things, you'll notice the silhouette is still very much a part of that design, despite all of the realistic dynamic principles, you know, of how folds lay and material interacts with the actor. And some areas are looser and some are tighter, really about the understanding. Just showing you how to break it down and approach it so you don't get so intimidated by looking at the source material. Especially when you're in front of one in the museum, it's always like, oh, I don't know where to start first. And constantly, just like a painting, continue to jump around. So pick an angle that you want to work for when you get into your assignments and start to break it down. And it doesn't matter what you want to draw on. If you want to draw, and I suggest ballpoint pen, you don't have the options of undo. All of this is going to really help you make the right decision when you're designing a creature, your primary source material being a realistic subject, a real animal in this case. But I want to kind of keep that almost bird's eye view on things at first, and then you can get in there and start dissecting it even a little bit more. All right, I hope you enjoyed this lesson. Now go download the reference images and draw this stuff yourself. And if you want more lessons like this, go ahead and check out the course. Premium students are the ones who make free lessons like this possible.